Georgetown at center, number 33, a 7-foot, 220-pound freshman from Cambridge, Massachusetts, Pat Ewing.
Baseline gets it off for Ewing, working Addison. Two!
Send it in, Patrick.
It's Ewing in traffic, hits it, and he's fouled. What a play. Off for Ewing, 7-point Hoya lead. They're on their way to the title. Well-deserved standing ovation for the tournament MVP, Patrick Ewing, all smiles with his coach.
It doesn't take a genius to tell you Patrick Ewing and Georgetown go together like peanut butter and jelly. And the Fieldhouse senior writer Dana O'Neill says his name, and I guess one other, will always be synonymous with the Hoyas program.
You know, he's it. He is Georgetown, second only to John Thompson Jr., right? I mean, if you say Georgetown, you say Patrick Ewing.
Patrick Ewing took over as head coach of his alma mater on April 3rd. But his journey to get Georgetown back to the pinnacle of college basketball isn't exactly an easy one. Although he may not have known the true rigors of coaching college basketball until the summer, O'Neill and Syracuse assistant coach Adrian Autry explain his obvious advantage now trying to bring back the glory days to D.C.
I saw him in July, and he looked kind of exhausted. I mean, the recruiting process in July is exhausting. But he's smart enough to know he doesn't have to play the game. I mean, he's Patrick Ewing. You want to play for him or you don't. It's really not that complicated. You know, as you walk in the door as Patrick Ewing, you have instant credibility as a coach and as a recruiter.
You would play for a Hall of Fame or someone that's been at that level trying to get to where you're getting to. That can only help, and I think it really kind of gives those guys credibility that you have not only an NBA coach, player, but a Hall of Famer in the collegiate level and in the professional level.
Like Autry mentioned, Ewing was an NBA guy. The Hall of Famer was an NBA assistant since 2002 before he left the Hornets in the spring. But take it from his former Knicks teammate, Greg Anthony, who has worked as an analyst for both the college and pro ranks. Pat's going to be just fine making the transition.
In some respects, the fact that our league has gotten so much younger will help, right? Because we've had a lot of young players come in after 1 year of college or even no college there for a while until the rule changed. So he's had some experience in that capacity.
With that much out of the way, now it turns to Coach Ewing's job to establish an identity. And as O'Neill says, he doesn't need to create a new one. It's all about looking back at the 80s when the Hoyas were among the most feared in the country.
I sat down with him in the beginning of the season and we kind of went through all of that Hoya paranoia when he was very much respected but also universally detested as a college basketball player because he was so dominant and they were so good and they were so mean and they had that whole sort of nasty image. And I said, that had to be difficult. And he kind of laughed. He said, they hated us because they were good. He said, I hope they hate us again soon.
Turning a future thought into a present problem is the challenge. But coach may not have to go the five-star one-and-done route. It may wind up coming down to bringing in the kids who just fit the system.
I think he wants kids with an edge who feel like they have to play nasty defense. They have to be known for being able to stop people. So I think that's a really smart direction to go to because not only does it fit with the image of Georgetown, but it will work well in the Big East.
And it starts by taking care of business in his backyard.
D.C. has had a lot of really great talent, but it has not stayed home. I mean, you look at Villanova's national championship team, and there were three guys from D.C. on Villanova's roster, right? So those are the kind of kids, you know, that he has to keep home if they're going to be successful.
And if things don't always work out in the D.C., Maryland, Virginia area, Ewing has a vote of confidence from many former colleagues. And who knows? Maybe their sons might end up at Georgetown.
There's no doubt that Georgetown is a place that we have tremendous affection for. And obviously, Patrick is someone who I have a lot of respect for and would never have an issue with my son playing for him.
No matter what happens with Greg Anthony's son's commitment next year, Greg is confident his friend will find the winning formula.
One thing I can always say about Patrick, nobody will ever outwork him, ever, in any facet. And I think the fact also that it's his alma mater, it's the place that kind of gave him his start. The fact that his coach is the one that really wanted to see this come to fruition motivates him even more.
As for O'Neill, it's important to manage expectations. Remember, this is a program that went to the Final Four three times in Ewing's career as a player and just one time since his graduation in 1985. So we may have to wait a couple of years to see his full effect take place because, after all, patience is a virtue.
You have to be realistic. I mean, this isn't Kentucky where you're going to go recruit 5 one-and-done players tomorrow and all of a sudden you're going to be in the Elite Eight. Look, I covered Jay Wright back in the beginning when they wanted to fire him after 2 NIT runs. I think you need to give coaches a couple of years, especially in these unique circumstances when they're trying to rebuild something.